Okay, let's do the big clap.
3, 2, 1.
This is Artwork Play Podcast. I don't remember what else to say. I can say that again. Oh, shit. Jonathan dropped the phone. I don't actually remember what we talked about.
That's just what Ben talked about, getting too fired up in the podcast. I'm already too fired up.
Too fired up? Oh, because you're dropping the phone and stuff? Yeah, are we just introducing this is Artwork Play Podcast? A podcast?
Yeah, you're doing a great job so far.
This is Artwork Play Podcast, a podcast about art, work, and play.
Damn, there we go. So, who are we? We're Spec Work. What is Spec Work?
Sometimes I tell people it's a studio. Other times I tell people it's a collective. It's not really much of anything. A loose agreement to continue working on. It's more the projects that we've put into it so far. It's a website. It's a URL specifically.
Spec Work is a game design collective made up of currently myself, Kat Blumke, Jonathan Carroll, and
me,
you,
Ben McCarthy. And then what are our respective contributions?
What's yours?
Well, I do sound design and composition, and then depending on the project, we come together and kind of develop concepts together. And then, you know, periodically we get together and talk shit and speculate about making other projects together. So far we have, what, 3 or 4 projects that we have shared with the world? And then, as you point out, we have the website.
Yeah, you always want to get more projects on that website. Because then I feel like there's more things we could put on. But yes, I think there's, well, there's like, you could think of it as being each of us sort of has their own, their project that they're like spearheading in the collective. So that's one way of thinking about it. But
true.
As to the, who the is, what I do programming.
For contributions, yeah, I lend design and
you lend it.
I lend design and visual direction.
But you want it back.
Yeah.
Unwillingly lend design. And yeah, each of us have contributed sort of a brainchild of our own that the others have reared a little, I suppose.
So today we're like getting the podcast off the ground, trying to get the Twitch stream off the ground. We've been fucking around with the audio and visual for like, what, 45 minutes? And we're finally...
hours.
But we're doing it. It's happening. And today we want to talk a little bit about organization, unions, and specifically of gig workers, which connects to some of the themes we've explored in our games. And we want to do a playthrough of Holler,
which is the no-frills game that none of us have played yet, but almost seems like the horrible real version of the kind of tongue-in-cheek game Gigco that we put out earlier this year, where in Gigco, our project, you're an Amazon factory worker, sort of a gig worker trying to avoid automation. In No Frills, the grocery store's game, Holler Online, it seems, we haven't played it yet, but it seems you're just a regular person who's trying to cut corners at their local No Frills.
Cut corners literally and figuratively.
Yeah, at their No Frills and avoid, it's some sort of side scroller. So you're trying to avoid
things. This could conceptually be in a game that is set in the gig economy. If the shopper was working for DoorDash or something like that, mm-hmm. One of those gig economy apps where people order groceries through the app and someone goes and picks the groceries up at a grocery store.
And I think there's several grocery store chains that offer that. I mean, Amazon was offering a service in the States.
Walmart's doing it. I'm not sure
if it was successful. Yeah, and then I saw PC, so which is owns
connected
No
to
Frills.
No Frills.
Yeah, I believe.
Also, no, I don't. That's what I was wondering. Right, because No Frills has President's
Choice.
Well,
No Frills has President's Choice, I assume they're like part of the same parent company.
Yes, yeah, definitely.
Like a Loblaws parent company.
And Loblaws is owned by, what's his face, Weston, right?
Which is the president. He owns the President's Choice.
He's the president who's making all the choices.
It's true.
About but bilking us for bread and
price. They're the ones who did price literal bread price fixing,
and they're like a Canadian legacy family. I don't know, like, and they've kind of been around for a while. They have streets in this city, for instance.
Are they also the Westin Hotels? Is that also them?
Or no, that's West? Spelled differently. They're Westin Weston Bread, right?
And Westin.
Are they Westin
right.
Bread?
Maybe I'm confused as well.
Yeah.
No, I just heard in another podcast that besides this one, that soon this will be the only podcast I listen to. But until now, there has been no other podcast. This podcast has not existed, so I've had to listen to other podcasts. But they said the Westin guy is the second richest guy in Canada.
Who's the first?
Who's the first? Justin Trudeau.
You get that rich doing brown face. You can't get that rich until you start doing brown face. roughly the theme is organization, our organizing the podcast, union mm-hmm. organization, and food. So, John, you wanted to talk about this article this article and this movement to organize Foodora.
Yeah, the Foodora workers that the company calls them riders in Toronto voted to unionize.
Shout out Thomas McKechnie, who, like, a Toronto playwright who is also spearheading that initiative.
Man, playwrights for radical change.
Well, great. He takes that seriously. So,
they voted to unionize over the summer, and the corporation, the company, launched this really awesome looking website that was like, just say no.
With a picture of a nice white lady.
Yeah, nice, happy looking rider. And the
white ladies being like the most popular type of rider that one encounters ordering from Google, I'm sure.
They voted, they were about to vote for it, and then it was called up to the question of whether or not Foodora's the people who work for Foodora counted as workers was brought to the courts, because the contention by Foodora is that their workers are just contractors because they're just working through the app. App functioning is some sort of like always temporary contract.
So this absurd reality is that the people who are working, what is contested? The contested issue from the company side is the people who are working for Foodora, whose work is to ride for Foodora, are not workers. So they can't be unionized under the Postal Worker Union because they're not workers. That's the absurd crux of it. And so that they took is being blocked.
They did vote, and people voted, and people were rallying around the vote, but that vote will not be disclosed. It will not be counted.
That's
will not
wild.
Be opened.
The decision exists. Oh, man, so wild.
It's a Schrodinger's box. But the thing about it is like, this is like a classic union ploy.
Anti-union ploy?
Sorry, you got it. Yeah, an anti-union ploy where these issues are contested, and then the same thing happened for part-time workers, I think the article says, for the Ontario College. The same thing happened when Wynn forced the elementary school's teachers back to work. This was contested, they're forced back to work. And then very quietly, a settlement was paid out to the teachers who were who are forced back to work in a fashion that doesn't honor or respect their collective bargaining agreement.
A settlement, as in they just paid them off? Like they just
paid them like they had to take the lumps. So like part of it is the teacher's right to strike was summarily trodden over, and then the government, oh yeah, we got that wrong here, we'll just pay you a little bit. But in the meantime, the teachers were forced into arbitration instead of being able to negotiate for their contracts.
What does arbitration mean?
Arbitration is when a government official comes in and negotiates between the two sides, the company, and in this case, the elementary school teachers. I'm a college professor. That's one thing I should have said amongst like what I do. And we went on strike in 2017 for about 5 weeks, and we also got legislated back to work, and the arbitration came down. There were some wins and losses, and that's the way arbitration tends to shake out. A lot of the union brass for my union kind of thought arbitration tends to benefit us in such a harsh anti-union climate. And that's why these legislative knots that some of these votes get tied in are so problematic, not just because it keeps kicking the can down the road for the workers who are looking for change, but in the media, in the propaganda mill, it looks like unions are powerless. So it kind of like is bad for morale, bad for the union brand into the bargain.
Whoa. Like it makes it look like all the effort you're going through to be a union, to be a part of a union, to be like the rank and file in a union is pointless because...
It's pointless. It's very Tino, right? It's very Reagan, Thatcher. There's no alternative. You just have to... And you can see it in that article that you passed us, John, the CBC article, where the Fedora guy is like, oh yeah, well, they can try and kick up their little dust storm, but at the end of the day, you can't unionize a gig worker.
Oh, right. That's what they were saying, that the gig workers could kick up their dust storm, but because they're contractors. And so it's gone to that. That's arbitration. That's what's happening right now between Fedora and its workers.
Yeah. And that can take literal months. Like we were out for 5 weeks and our we had to work without a contract for several months, which is not technically legal, but that's what happened. And then there was no settlement for us when we had to work without a contract.
But did you get paid while you were working without a contract?
Yeah, we got paid our old contract as far as I remember. But until it was negotiated, we also had to make up for all the lost work. So we had to compress our courses and we had to, pay extra care to the students, which of course you don't mind doing, but that means we're doing more to kind of like make up for the strike, and you never get remunerated for that.
It is interesting to think of the gig workers for Fedora, because they have no they have no physical infrastructure that they engage in as workers. There's no break room that they all congregate at or whatever.
Just pink bicycles in the city.
Yeah, they can identify each other, which actually we saw a couple when we were in Berlin. I walked by a couple like gatherings of whatever the equivalent for Fedora is in Berlin, where it's like everyone was wearing, and they said it was some sort of like organization meeting or something like that. But besides the unifying jackets, yeah, they have no sort of shop floor to meet on or whatever, except for the app, right? Like the app is the only sort of, it's technically the property that the company is like offering them to work upon, and then but they can't even communicate on this app. Like in the joke, the fake gig economy company we made, GigCo, has an app where employees can message each other. But
there's no similar. And in that, it's because in this future dystopia, or just this alternative dystopia, the idea that the Facebook and Amazon, Walmart, they all exist as the same company. So then they would share. Yeah, they'd
there'd just be one messaging system.
Yeah,
but I don't actually know if there's a way for Foodora employees to message each other. Maybe there's.
You should, John. You were reading to me and Kat from the app. Weren't you looking at the app, and the language in the app was kind of amusing and like.
I was looking at their hiring page. I think that's what I was looking at. That their number, like the can I hear, can I bring it
you
up?
Bring it up.
I just want to point cropped a little.
I want to point out to people, part of our experiment with this podcast is we're also trying to get a Twitch stream going with it. We're trying to record it, so there's this visual component, and what you're missing now by just listening to this as a podcast and not seeing it on the stream is the official, what would you call Sam, Kat? Like a mascot, a fourth member,
a leader
and figurehead has crept into the scene and is kind of like dominating Kat's attention to some degree right now.
Yeah, kind of taking over.
He was screaming earlier, and so I just had to do something. Yeah, there's almost like motivational. Oh, good. I'm glad.
That looks great. Okay,
that's awesome. So now we're looking at the application website for Foodora, and they have all these beautiful riders in their branded pink and gray gear.
They don't look like they're working. They look like they're just hanging out.
Chilling. Yeah. They look like they're emphatically chilling.
That's kind of how it's... Yeah, it's definitely... Explore your city is not necessarily a work... Yeah, it doesn't...
Oh yeah,
it's not synonymous with work.
Ride around and become a trip advisor for your friends.
You'll see something new every day. you can piggyback your job. The first guy's got a very socialist realism look. If you scroll back up to the white guy, the first, he's like looking into the future with his beautiful blue eyes and his little curls.
A perfectly branded bike helmet.
Yeah. Is there a bit of a gradient? No, it's just light.
That tips, yes, please. Well, at least they're not garnishing all their wages. Well, wow. I don't know. They would be they'd be awesome to hear what the story is with that.
Yeah, like with Uber when I was or Lyft, I think it was in the States. Lyft was trying to set themselves apart as the company that allowed you to tip, therefore was the better option for the rideshare.
Uber was.
No, Lyft was saying that they had tipping.
Yes, right.
But then when I was actually talking to the people, because we were taking a Lyft, they said like they couldn't actually see the amount that was tipped. And I could be wrong about this. Like this could have changed, so I could be corrected. But then, I ended up just giving people cash because how do you know that's actually going to the riders? Just drivers in this case.
Well, they're all riding something.
They're all ride or die. The gig economy ride.
It'd be easy content for, like, if we wanted to do interviews in this podcast, just interviewing gig economy workers would be amazing content.
Yeah, I like that.
Every statement does sound like this crazy double think propaganda, but the next sort of selling point for the Foodora job is reclaim your time, part-time or full-time, decide when to work and spend your time off doing what you love. Oh God.
Isn't that right? Like, yeah. Touring your city and showing your friends your cool city.
Doing what you love, AKA your tour bus operator job.
Yeah. How many is that? Okay, Sam, do you want that?
Oh yeah, this is important as well. Like the what you'll need section, of course.
Specifically first, it actually needs your
mobile device, bike, car, or scooter, and then eligible to work in Canada and older than 18. Yeah, so you need there.
It's the same guy, very consistent. It's nice, like way to finish.
Their whole sort of. It's like their manifesto, the gig economy manifesto, is sort of just stated in their hiring webpage.
This idea that it's freeing the fact that you have no regular schedule and no guaranteed wage.
In this context where like we so frequently vote with our dollars, and like when the, who is the CEO of Uber? cat, and then he kind of came out in support of Trump, and then he had to step down, and everybody abandoned Uber.
Oh yeah, that was why. That was during the election. No,
and afterwards, people specifically like, when the taxis went on strike in New York, stopping
that's right,
taking
that's
people
the one.
From the airport, but Uber continued to take people to and from the airport when there was a mass demonstration against the. I can't remember what it was. I think it was when. Trump
did the
got
Muslim
rid of all
ban
yeah, the Muslim
sort of
ban.
Thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's exactly what it was.
So
and so people ceremoniously, you know, deleted the app. And then I of course, you know, I like to be like critical of this sort of reactionary thing. And then I like dutifully abandoned Uber Eats to go over to Foodora hearing about the unionization thrust. I wonder if it's been impacting I wonder if people are switching over to Foodora. They're hearing that it's a unionized shop.
You're saying it's all like a psyop from the side of Foodora?
Yes.
This is some like Vladislav Surkov shit. Like they're putting in pro-union instigators knowing full well that they can like... But I guess they why would they want to appear like the evil company that's they should just go full on with the union. They'd get a lot maybe get a lot more business. But no, business is just afraid of unions.
Yeah, too scary to be real.
It's not even that's what's so crazy. So like, you know how socialism talking about labor is becoming more popular.
Yeah, I just saw a Twitch streamer. He was, in fact, Wikipedia-ing live social Democrats.
He was looking up social democracy on his Twitch stream. And everyone was like,
the concept. Yeah.
Pretty good.
People feeding in.
But with the growing popularity of like. Socialism and then implicitly like labor politics, I wonder sometimes how capitalism will find a way to co-opt that, like how we'll find a way to make the Urban Outfitters or the American Apparel of like socialism. Do you know what I mean? The
same way. This is just like history return. Like Che Guevara was branded
true.
And Marx is too, like you see all the memes where they take up Marxist discourse, and I think even us filtering these sorts of ideas through these digital platforms to a degree is already doing that work.
Yes,
we're already like this is more free content. This is more free work. We're already doing that.
Like yeah, Twitch itself, the platform which we are attempting to use.
Wait, watch what you say.
Oh.
No, I'm joking.
Twitch is a company owned by Amazon, which is exactly the company we take subject of scrutiny of a joke that we present in our project Ginkgo. So they acquired Twitch, but it is also like a large.
They also call their workers contractors. The warehouse workers are contracted
in Amazon.
Yeah.
Yes.
And which is also, such a hilarious invention. This whole idea of the contract worker. Yeah. It's so hilarious. It's like, oh, no, we're you have to sign and say that you get less rights. So it's fair. You signed that. Our hands are tied.
When it's like
an Oculus, it's the same thing with the VR too. Like we're trying to do this VR work about frontline workers, and then Oculus is like run by this guy who's like an open Trump supporter. Which I mean, we don't need to be reductive or anything like that. Like, but like Trump is not directly contributing to the opioid crisis, or at least I haven't heard that hot take. But it's the purity politics are impossible when you're doing digital media.
You are just doing like you're engaging in this sort of techno feudalism we complain about in a big way.
Exactly.
Yeah. In all of our parts.
But we are doomed to always become the subjects of our work, I think. So, or, you know, the subjects of our art. So. Like, I don't know, we're all living in intern purgatories of our own.
Unfortunately, yes.
So
Jonathan's
watch.
Was specifically mentioning, I suppose the...
What were you going to say, Ben?
I was going to say we want to watch how the Foodora thing unfolds. It seems like it's going to certainly the company Foodora has managed to kick the can down the road in terms of arbitration. Hopefully,
well, there won't be any energy left. Like, is that that's
precisely part of the impetus. But I mean, to try and be a little bit more objective, the union itself offered its own kind of contentious issues, and that also is impacting the process. And then we're definitely want to be like rah-rah unions and everything like that, but you do see how they're, and this is something we've discussed before, but unions and corporations are kind of born in the same creche, and you see how they're playing by their own mutual set of technocratic rules. And can you imagine? I mean, yes, there are certainly much, much more precarious jobs, but this is a very precarious job, riding around on a bike, especially in the dead of winter. I just love this idea of have your time to yourself. You don't get to stop. If you're trying to make a living wage in Toronto, what time? Where is this time coming from? the precarity is just exacerbated. And it is a thing that ideally should happen and needs to happen. And the can is kicked down the road. But we're at about halfway. Do you want to switch into this playthrough?
Yeah, let's do it. Do you have any final thoughts, Kat?
On the Foodora topic? No. I mean, I haven't actually read the article that we were citing, so.
Awesome.
Let's get straight into it. No, I think
that gives you fresh eyes. Wait, now, so Foodora, is it meant to evoke a fedora?
Yes.
Is this like a, is it, what, who's what's, is it like a Milady reference? Is it?
Yeah, I wasn't sure either when they started popping out on the scene. It seems like exactly, you know, fedora was very much in public jargon, I think, or at least in our circles at the time. So
it is a word you can chew on. I mean, it does have that quality, but the evoking the image of the fedora just seems.
It's because what is it? Wasn't their logo also like a dinner plate? So I thought it was supposed to be reminiscent of like the hat shape.
Right. I want to look at their market research. I want to know how they arrived at that. They've got some like Don Draper creatives.
Perhaps it was just like food to door. Like,
oh, yeah.
I mean,
that's how it happens.
That's totally it. But it's, and the "at" is just like an arabesque to like round off the
exactly
the baby pablum of a title.
Food door. Food. It's like cellador.
Right.
The most beautiful word.
The most sibilant word.
It's from Donnie Darko.
It's the softest word.
It's
just from English. It's just a thing English teachers tell students to mystify them. It's the sound of one hand clapping.
But the transition to Holler. No Frills presents Holler Isles of Glory back to school. So it's
We're actually.
Wait, you got to leave space for the music, John. I thought you wanted music. Now I'm going to put the music over your transition.
So No Frills came out with this video game in the summer months, or was it even earlier? I can't remember. But it's a browser game.
It was in the spring they did the first version, if that's what you're getting at.
Yes, that's so we haven't actually played it, but it's a browser-based side scroller from
Nostalgia Core.
Yes, and it's so if you're not viewing the recording of the stream, you have an image of it's it is very much like what is this ratio? The ratio, like 3-4 ratio,
4-3
ratio, pixel, like pixel art. You have a yellow gradient with a yellow store in the back that is clearly a No Frills. And in this edition, there is a yellow school bus pulled up, all in the same color palette as well. A hauler in this wonderful 3D font that towers over you.
Can we talk about Holler for a minute? What the fuck is Holler supposed to mean? We'll link the game in the show notes so you can like play along if you want. Mm-hmm. But what the fuck does Holler mean? This is more mystifying than Foodora.
They have, I've noticed that they have at certain No Frills, very large shopping carts. And on those shopping carts, there will be, but however, they're not shopping carts for use by just any normal person. They're solely promotional shopping carts. They're to contain a whole bunch of one thing, generally to promote that thing.
Oh, like a sale item.
And then it's very large, like twice as long as a normal shopping
Sounds
cart.
Sounds absurd.
And it yeah, entirely. Yeah, like just think of how you would maneuver such a large cart. And
they're already unwieldy, famously.
Not only that, but there is absurdly like a fake license plate on the shopping cart.
No,
and that license plate says Holler on it.
I think it came out at the same time as their fashion brand, which I don't know whatever happened with that fashion brand, but at least here in Toronto, you can buy, yellow and black, sexily, it looks like very indie. Somebody would sell these shirts on Instagram or something like that.
Do they have like no name branding on the front of them or something?
Yeah, it's very like that, but it's like Holler, and then you kind of got like, it looks kind of like screen printed. I'm remembering it wrong, but
there's just so much to say about this game, really. Like, yeah. Just because No Frills itself is so weird, how it's like it's a hipster brand, but it's like co-opted from being a working class Canadian brand. But yeah, it has this hipster cachet.
Yeah,
if you just look into
the history of its actual like conception, it's just, you know, we're going to offer a select number of somewhat nutritional products that are available for a cheaper price.
Yeah, it's archly neoliberal. It's like,
yeah.
This is your austerity store. Come to the austerity shop. And then like the hipster is like a byword for like middle class people LARPing as working class people. And so you go to
austerity fetishists.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I was really struggling, you know. I had to get the no. And so we should mention here too that the branding was produced by an OCAD student. I wonder if they're seeing any of the revenues of the from off the Holler fashion line.
They definitely hired some new advertising agency to do their ads recently, and I wonder if we should do more.
We should find out who that person is and get them on the podcast.
We should find out who designed this game as well and get them on the podcast.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, no, it's very fitting to kind of have these kind of like unrecognized artists working behind the scene to.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I mean, retconning the beginning of the podcast where we did a quick introduction. A lot of the kind of concretizing force between or behind spec work coming together as a video game or interactive media focused collective was our interest in like how we see these a lot of these precarious jobs that run through the apps like Uber or Foodora, like we were talking about today. There is, of course, the people who are behind designing these things, and the digital side, the digital infrastructure that are creating like the bonds of this labor force is equally something that interests us, and the people who are actually behind creating all these like gamified the gamified working conditions that are like where it pushes you to work a bit harder or perhaps you'll get more rewards if you work a bit longer are something to be like scrutinized and examined. And so that's where a lot of this, the idea of like art, work and play kind of intersect, is that you have this overlapping between what are the technologies or the mechanics that are behind certain kinds of exploitative behavior, like exploitative behavioral triggers for keeping you on Facebook longer, but will also be used then to make the Foodora workers work longer and make you also like play Call of Duty for
and
longer.
Shop
and shop in this case because you're going to be a hauler at the end and that's incentivized. So the yeah, picking this as a picking this topic as a first thing to explore, or this particular game to explore, opens up onto the broader context of the kind of work that we're doing.
Totally.
It's also crazy they're still developing it, because yeah, this is like a this is an updated like expansion pack for the original hauler. Fans of the original hauler might notice that there is now a school bus in front of the No Frills.
I wonder how long the studio has been contracted to update this.
Yeah. Okay, so the other question is, maybe we can answer this after we play the game, but if No Frills paid us, how much money would they have to pay us to make this game? How much money would you guys need to make this game?
That's a question that we'll be able to answer at the end.
I'm just wondering.
The answer is yes, Kat. If it's a,
yeah, I want an itemized budget. No, it's like, what price do you need? Would you have to sell out to this level?
Hmm. Well, I mean,
more or less than $100,000.
Well, it's not that I wouldn't be placing judgment on the people who are developing it, because there is there is a glut of video game workers, in Toronto, and
I'm just saying you would do it for a certain amount of money, and I wouldn't do it for there is a certain minimum amount of money, and then I would totally make something like this. I think it might be about $100,000 for me.
Knowing that
I have to wait till the playthrough, you know, all will be revealed.
Okay, Kat, I'm going to play.
So we're doing this absurd thing where if you're not following the Twitch, so we're going to try and do a play-by-play to keep you updated. So Kat gave us the landing screen. There's this back to school that's what is supposed to evoke spray paint or something. There's layers of nostalgia here.
Yeah, if it's not graffiti style, I guess it's just like handwritten like pixel art. I'm gonna click.
And also notice it also says credits 1 in the lower right hand corner.
Oh yeah, well there's clearly there's a score. Yeah, it's
do they have this on any? If they built, you know how like indie arcade cabinets is a thing. If they had an indie arcade cabinet with this on it in a No Frills, I would lose my shit.
I'm gonna look at the game rules, because I always do that. Oh, it's opening. It's not in the app. Whoa. The objective.
Wow. Brings you to the No Frills website.
nofrills.ca/game rules. Not even. That's amazing. Whoa. Can I exit this?
No, you must select your location. Divulge.
So now it's doing a data scrape on us.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's asking where we are.
And Kat, like a fool, said where they were, which province.
The objective of this single-player side-scrolling game is to train for your next haul. That's crazy. By choosing a character and assuming the role of a hauler. The hauler will run seamlessly through the produce, packaged goods, bakery, and meat aisles of your local No Frills trademark store to earn points for hauling grocery items, hauls.
Yeah,
gaining power-ups while avoiding pesky frills and treacherous obstacles.
Pesky frills. See, this is like austerity propaganda.
Yeah. Oh my God. You choose
it's
a character.
It's training you. It literally just says it's training you.
You choose a character, that's important, and assume the role of a hauler. Your hauler will start each game with 3 lives. Okay,
I think, yeah.
But I just want to go one step further, because there's product placement. So apart from their own brands, they're also placing like Pringles is paid to be a part of this game.
There's a list of hauls that you can get, and
no names here.
Of the hauls included, Pringles original flavor is one of them, alongside bananas and steak and avocado. Exactly.
Avocados, I should mention. Yeah,
toilet paper. Avocados, don't forget the toilet paper.
Yeah, and no name's chilling a big bucks to be a vanilla and chocolate cream. I've never eaten one of those.
actually, I'm getting kind of hungry.
PC Organics frozen pizza.
Frills. Okay, the idea of the game is to also avoid frills. Once your hauler hits a frill, you lose one of your hauler's 3 lives. Frills will be represented as 8-bit versions of things you won't be able to find in your local No Frills.
So not just like Kalamata olives in a jar, like a chalkboard.
Frills include classic back-to-school elements such as an overhead projector, a chalkboard, a bus filled with gold and gemstones. What the fuck?
You can see who this is aimed at. This is aimed at us. This is not aimed at children, because a child has no idea what a fucking overhead projector is.
Oh, yeah, that's a really good point.
A classic school TV. They just have computers.
Yeah.
They just have one iPad per class now.
Well, Augie's class has this giant whiteboard, they call it, but it's basic, and the teachers do just put on YouTube.
Wow. And who is Augie, Ben? Are you going to disclose Augie?
Augie's my kid. They're a 9-year-old. I won't say which institution they went to, so I don't just ship them in public.
And what class? How can you get in contact?
And if you were to give the name of like a guardian that could pick them up after school, like what would that name be?
Exactly. I wasn't even thinking of that angle.
All right, well, I'm going to get pumped.
Get a haul. Get a haul.
Cats vaping jewels and drinking Gatorade.
Mm-hmm. There you go.
Do
that on screen. It's good for our
brand.
Yeah,
you can't actually say vape on Twitch, I'm pretty sure. Or at least you can't do this vapes.
This is
just carbonated water. So let's vape, hit start. Vape. Let's hit that flashing alleged start button. Vape.
Summer is over, is scrolling text on screen. Yeah. But the fight against frills is just heating up. Fuck this.
Did Doug Ford write this?
It's time to train for your big back to school haul. Get the snacks. Dodge the frills. Hauler class is back in session.
Ooh.
Because, okay, yeah.
There should be some sound effects that right now.
No, there should be, but there isn't.
But there's not. Yeah, there's no sound effects.
School is, of course, like always training us how to like
be better
reproduce workers. Like what society wants us to reproduce, right? So to haul.
To haul?
To haul above all.
Okay. All right, I'm going to hit next. Am I prepared? Okay, so actually it was clicking, but now it's switch lanes is up and down and space bar. But I think I have to hit okay with my mouse in order to proceed.
Collect these. Okay, yeah.
Click good. Those. Click ooh, those.
Avocados.
Graphical error.
Yes.
Yeah, this is really interesting. So I believe avocados are either 666 points or 800.
I bet it says 800.
No, it's 666. They're definitely doing something here. This is the poor unpaid game workers trying to reach out.
There is a 100 point box of different items. I think roast chicken is one of them.
Yeah,
much more lower, valuable than lower 100 points. There's a 300 point category that has. That's where the no frills naturally imperfect brand peppers are.
Those are
and then there's I think it's an 800 points box that has avocado steak and then branded Pringles.
How much do you think?
Which
Pringles
is like what is the what
like
is yeah
top item
top this. Tier item
top tier item.
They're like Pringles. We're gonna put you in the $100
way above. Of roasted chicken and
I'm sensing some thematic inconsistencies here because how is steak not a frill?
That's true.
Well, is any? Yeah.
I don't think I've
Pringles are a staple, obviously, but
I think sort of the statement of this so far with it saying like, oh, you know, things like projectors, buses, it's saying anything except for food is a frill.
Right.
So it's like, which is always the goal of because the goal of capital is to reduce the cost of the worker staying alive to be as minimal as possible so they can scrape as much surplus value off of that worker's work. So it's like, yeah, the more frills they can impose, which is why they should probably take away the steak and the, I guess it's like only everything except for food is a frill. That's a good ideology for capitalism.
Well, and then I like also like here in Ontario where there's all these cuts to education that the implements of education, such as they are represented in this game, are themselves frills that ought to be put.
Oh my God. Oh, I didn't even think of that angle. Oh, that's so dark. Is that
and this the steak is probably there because you know Canadian beef and cows eat grass and grass absorbs
true.
Carbon.
Shout out so, Alberta.
Yeah, if you like eat more beef, you're actually like doing good for the
you're
planet.
You're a patriot. You're a goddamn patriot. And
yeah,
a
not only are you supporting your country, but you are also growing more grass.
What is the
which fight climate change?
So this is like Fordist propaganda, like Fordist hipster propaganda.
You mean Doug Ford? Or yes. Do you, okay.
Henry. He means Henry.
Yeah.
Well, maybe it's Fordist in that it's like about reducing us to like a tail, an atomized like
assembly line.
Okay, you want to hit okay?
All right. So up and down, and let's see if that works. Oh, no. Actually, so I have to use my mouse. Bad design here. So the controls in the game are arrow keys and space bar, but you actually have to click through
the menu.
Okay,
oh. Here are the frills.
Wow, that bus Damn. Is huge.
These are really nice pixel art yeah. of a bus filled with money. That's hilarious. Chalkboard that says frills many times, like Bart Simpson writing frills on it a bunch of times. A TV that sells frills.
Also looks like, yeah, has a VCR player.
Very cool. Yeah, very like, these are all very reminiscent of when we went to school.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, there's frills. That, yeah. Let's avoid those frills.
Ooh, some power-ups. Okay, so coins. Looks like coins, extra life, triple jump, hall magnet, cool, power hauler.
They're all displayed on coins, right?
Yeah, they're That's displayed on coins.
Different power-ups that, we can collect.
I guess like signs that you can also get. Oh, don't lose your hearts.
You have three hearts.
You have three hearts. That's my, these are my instructions.
Okay, and now we have the character selection screen.
Very du jour, lots of representative characters.
Yeah, but all, I think like, this person's
even
old.
Like a hipster granny.
Yeah,
this person's old.
I think that's what they're supposed to do. Oh, I still have to click this. I guess I'll be yeah
a strong granny.
Strong.
That's yeah the least cultural appropriation.
Yeah.
Dude, them being the man would be cultural appropriation. No frills. Won't be beat. Crawford's no frills. Is that Whoa. A really existing no frill somewhere?
I don't hear anything yet. There's
so we're no, actually... we won't be able to hear it.
Oh, yeah, it's, okay. But it is recording. It. All right. Okay, so she's I'm already starting. No
Lots of
okay.
Pringles
bing,
branding.
Bing, bing, bing. So the frame rate is like very low.
But I think that's the design of the yeah. game itself. I wonder if they made it using an engine or what.
Or, what do I'm not like, oh, fuck.
Or actually, it might be the stream. Yeah, I think we're just lagging it out. That's hilarious. This unplayable
oh my
game.
This is insane. Uh-oh, I died.
Dang.
No, wait. Yeah, I lost another heart.
Whoa, so, wait, aren't you usually, isn't Twitch, aren't you usually supposed to play games while you're streaming and stuff
yeah,
like that?
Yeah, I mean, I guess browser games. I'm not sure if that's like you think. Okay, now it just black screened.
I think you beat it, Kat.
Yeah. I think you won the game. Okay, well,
Damn.
Do you want it?
You're an excellent hauler.
Let's reload, see what happens.
And let's sort of talk about what was the actual action in the game.
Yeah.
So it was side-scrolling, like sort of what you would call a 2.5 view, a la Double Dragons, or what are the classic, like, sort of arcade fighting, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
And back to school font that we're looking at kind of evokes that too, kind of has that Double Dragon yeah. aesthetic.
Totally. And you're rushing from the left to the right as the character stays in the same place on the screen while everything else moves. Mm-hmm. But you can move up or down.
Or jump. But I couldn't really, I think, yeah, either
frame
the
rate
frame
was
rate
so,
was
so low that we
I couldn't
jump.
Tell
I think
I
it's
jumping.
Also hard to jump a lot of those obstacles. I think you need the power up to get over some of them.
Right.
Augie played the first one quite a bit. And so you mostly need to avoid, and then only when you have some of the power-ups are you able to jump over some of them.
But Augie was able to get farther than we just got, right?
Augie had a record, and I don't know if the record was, like, just on our screen or what, but, like, you know what I mean? Like, I don't know if it was
yes.
actually connected to anything or if it was, like, a false thing.
I don't see anywhere here where the scoreboard would be top of mind, I think. So it must just be I wonder how the score works.
I wonder how they're determining who's the greatest hauler and taking action.
Because the crazy
thing...
Well,
it's probably like low-hanging fruit. Like, they probably don't want it to... Like, they probably want everybody to have a sense of achievement. So they're not going to...
This is a game to make you feel good.
There's probably like a really...
going shop at No Frills.
Okay, so what is the point of this game? Like... I mean, it's design, it's inception. I don't mean like the object of the game. Why did they do this? And it's effective, clearly.
Mm.
Effective at what?
I mean, people are playing it, and it wasn't as if like this isn't something that you two discovered because you have like arcane video game knowledge. Like, this is somehow an effective
meme. Well,
and so is there? I feel like there's definitely a data scrape element.
Oh, so, okay. So you're sort of like talking in a material sense. What are they really gaining from this? Because I would think that because like video games like represent, even just mechanics themselves represent an aesthetic, and then this game is like just like loaded with a really specific nostalgic aesthetic.
Nostalgic drip.
Yeah, nostalgic sopping with it. It's just an item, an article of branding, an artifact that's supposed to,
and marketing, I guess, but only like this surface level marketing. I'm like, what's the deeper move here?
Well, training as well. Like, it's a it's like Foucauldian disciplinary tool where it's like, yeah, it's literally saying that it's training us to be haulers. What does it, do you think it needs a more of a material reason to exist than that? Like,
well, you don't often have
why would you, like, it clearly there's like a budget behind it, and there's a budget behind like creating the fashion label. So like, how would you get that approval? Like,
if you didn't have a good reason.
If you didn't have a good reason to spend that money. Unless they just, I mean, it is such a massive corporation. It just has like an advertising budget, and this just could have been how they chose to. I mean, you can only see so many like no frills won't be beat signs and or like ads and... like maybe they just wanted something drastically different. Oh, is it not coming up anymore?
Sorry, it was.
Oh.
Oh no! I don't think it is. Ben, what were you saying?
No, I mean that I didn't have more than that initial speculation, and Kat was like kind of expanding on my own intuition. It's just like, what the hell is the point? Because did you guys see the ads that went with the new push for Hauler? It's like these very similar types. So you have this like this representative, yes, cast, and they're all doing like parkour, right, through.
Oh yeah, okay, I do remember.
It looks like the
hashtag Hauler.
It's just as dripping,
but it's
with
very fashiony. Yeah, yeah. There, whoa, and there you see the t-shirts. Yeah.
Here we go, hashtag like, Hauler.
Ripping on Warhol. You kind of they have that screen print vibe. It kind of looks like a zine a little bit. It looks like a photocopy.
We're looking
zine
at posters advertising this campaign, Hauler, which is obviously, it's just like, oh, the Hauler is their fashion brand, eh?
Yeah.
We can look at this. No Frills officially launches from BlogTO. Academic publication.
It's own clothing. Clothing line.
Here it is.
So yeah, what is the, I'm saying about, like, besides training us, the game is just an item of branding, because which the goal of branding is to elicit a sort of interaction and response in the individual. And what can do that better than a game?
And the ephemera you wear.
Oh yeah, totally.
Yeah, so we're looking at BlogTO. Article from May 8th, 2018. So we're a bit late on this, but No Frills officially launches its own clothing line, is the headline. And there's an image of a person standing in a, no frills aisle, because it's
the frozen
entirely
foods
yellow
aisle.
Yeah, the frozen foods.
In an outfit best assembled from like vintage kit. Like, it's a very Value Village kind of look.
There's some sort of fur on the side. The person,
more.
Got some pop-ups that's happening. It's a Canadian discount store chain, No Frills. They of the free fruit-stained moving boxes and epic parking lot fights just dropped I'm not really sure if I want to read this out loud.
No.
They put out a couple different
items.
It did
say those who are expecting a Joe Fresh style experience will be disappointed. But it's key to remember that No Frills is not Loblaws. They're owned by the same company. That's what it says next.
Wow. These just
Should
the
we
images.
Wrap it up?
Yeah, I agree. What do you think the...
Oh, look.
Let's do some plugs.
Yeah, it's either it showed up. It was doing a Fyre Festival style Instagram advertising by putting yellow squares in Instagram.
Oh, I see. Classic.
Yeah.
Wait, let me get the hauler.
Yeah. As we
back here, we go. What do you got to plug? Well, yeah, we got a couple things we can plug.
I think we should plug the Brandscape doing rentals. Yeah. We have multiple studios available between $200 and $400, private studios, semi-private studios, and something we're calling Permodular, which allows you kind of to be in a kind of co-working space. It's also available for booking events. What's the address for that?
It's 1136 DuPont Street, Toronto.
At the corner of DuPont and Dufferin.
What is the
Brandscape? The Brandscape is a cool cooperative studio.
Very cool.
And very definitely cool. Very, very much the place to be if you are a hauler.
strip of art venues by Cooper Cole. And what else is up there?
Lyft, and the Toronto Animated Images Society, all the bars.
Mm-hmm. Close to X Space.
It's really got a lot of good. Brothers. It's like you get to hang out with all the people that we like to hang out with.
Come and put your shoulder to the gentrification wheel. No, that's not a plug anymore. What do you guys got to plug?
Well, we'll be showing our VR documentary called Resourced at
Workman Arts Festival.
Workman Arts at Rendezvous with Madness Festival is the name of the festival, right, which is happening on Toronto from the 10th to the 12th. The opening's on the 10th, and we'll be showing our VR piece. It's on the Oculus Quest, which is the a newer Oculus that's really takes
entirely
advantage.
Tetherless.
It's tetherless. The app takes advantage of that tetherless technology. We'll also be working on a new video to go along with this release. And then we're doing a talk as part of that festival on the 12th at the Toronto Media Arts Centre. The whole thing is at TMAC, the Toronto Media Arts Centre, which is on 32 Lisgar, I believe, in like Queen and Lisgar in Toronto.
And then
Kat, you get a plug.
You get a plug. So then I will also plug one of our collaborative projects, Intern Purgatory, which will be premiering at the Halifax Nocturnes Festival, Halifax's Nuit Blanche for those who are Toronto based. And it will be an exploded VR installation, meaning a 3-screen projection of some work that the Tough Guy Mountain Collective has created. Any East Coast fans show up on the 19th of October to Halifax's Nocturne Festival.
Come through. Kat, where can people find you if they want to find you on the internet?
Find me on the internet? You can find me on Instagram, Twitch, and Twitch at Kat Blimke. And
Instagram is also Kat Blimke?
Instagram, yeah, both of those are Kat Blimke. So that is my name, Katblumke. You can find our games online, the one we were referring to. We'll put them in the show notes, but also Escape the Gig Economy is at gigco.app. So that's gigco.app. And our studio, more of our games previews can be viewed online at spec.work. So that's spek.work.
Nice. Where do you find you, John?
Yeah, that's a great question. Ben's got a couple of emails you can reach him at.
You should spell them.
Yeah, I was trying to think of a good joke.
No. If they want to find me, they can find me at Instagram at paleeyesmusic.com. I have a playlist collecting my best music from the last 10 years, my various music projects. That's the best place to find me.
And that's is that playlist on Spotify?
You can find it in the bio. Yeah, it's linked in the bio to Spotify and Apple Music.
Yeah, don't just, it's hard to find Ben just looking up Pale Eyes on Google, but if you Google Pale Eyes music, you might find Ben. If you Google Pale Eyes music Ben McCarthy, you will definitely find Ben.
That's an SEO.
Sometimes when you could do just Pale Eyes music, you get the song Pale Blue Eyes by the Velvet Underground. Linger.
Maybe with that we say goodbye to each other.
Bye to each other, or bye just to the recording?
Let's pretend that we're saying goodbye to each other, but then we'll stay here and talk about what we just did.
Okay, yeah, it was great talking to you. Bye, Ben.
Really good, guys. Have fun out there.
Yeah, we haven't even told you. Thanks about so much. Our
move. Bye, Ben. Bye.
Next